Boa tarde. Sejam todas e todos bem-vindos ao Teatro Paulo Autran do Sesc Pinheiros. O Seminário Internacional Democracia em Colapso é uma realização do Sesc São Paulo e da Boitempo, com apoio da Fundação Rosa Luxemburgo, Fundação Maurício Grabois, Claxo e promoção de Folha de São Paulo, Marie Claire Brasil, Revista 451, Carta Capital e Rede Brasil Atual. Ao longo dos últimos 4 dias, o seminário promoveu discussões e reflexões sobre as origens e as diferentes perspectivas históricas, políticas e sociais que perpassam o conceito de democracia, com o objetivo de ampliar nossa capacidade de reflexão sobre o assunto e fomentar o estabelecimento do diálogo democrático. O seminário contou com o curso A Democracia Pode Ser Assim, Histórias, Formas e Possibilidades, e com um ciclo de debates, conferências e palestras com a presença de mediadores e debatedores nacionais e internacionais. Nesta tarde, temos a honra de receber Angela Davis, para a conferência de encerramento do seminário. Lembramos que o seminário está sendo gravado em sua íntegra e que os conteúdos serão brevemente disponibilizados online. A conferência de hoje, além de gravada, está sendo transmitida online pelos canais do Sesc São Paulo e da Boitempo no YouTube e pelo Facebook do Sesc São Paulo. Sua permanência na sala autoriza o eventual uso de sua imagem. Informamos que, após a conferência, o público presente no teatro poderá fazer perguntas por meio das fichas inclusas no bloco de notas do seminário. As perguntas deverão ser entregues e serão repassadas à mediadora Adriana Ferreira Silva, editora executiva da revista Marie Claire, a quem convidamos ao palco agora.
Boa tarde a todas e a todos que estão aqui hoje. Queria, primeiramente, agradecer à Boitempo e ao Sesc, que são os responsáveis por esse imprescindível ciclo de debates que a gente acompanhou nessa semana, e, principalmente, pelo convite por estar aqui nesse momento histórico. Por fim, obviamente, eu quero agradecer, em nome de todas e todos aqui presentes, a Angela Davis por vir ao Brasil nos inspirar com suas palavras, no momento em que a gente está precisando tanto de exemplos para lutar em favor dos oprimidos. Poucas pessoas viveram experiências tão dramáticas quanto a filósofa e professora emérita da Universidade da Califórnia, Angela Davis. Em sua autobiografia política, escrita em 1972 e finalmente lançada no Brasil pela Boitempo, Angela descreve o cenário de sua infância, quando descobriu o racismo morando num bairro que ficou conhecido como Dynamite Hill, a colina da dinamite, devido aos constantes bombardeios realizados por racistas e supremacistas brancos para intimidar e expulsar os vizinhos, famílias negras de classe média que começavam a se mudar para a região. A situação não era muito melhor em outros bairros de Birmingham, cidade no Alabama, onde ainda existia segregação quando Angela Davis nasceu em 1944. Em Nova York, onde fez o ensino médio, Angela descobriu que, apesar de a segregação não ser instituída como no restante dos Estados Unidos, tampouco era verdade a propagada harmonia racial do norte do país, pois o racismo estava entranhado nas estruturas políticas e sociais, criando a perseguição à população negra. Graduada pela Universidade de Brandeis, Angela Davis especializou-se em francês e cultura francesa em Paris, cidade onde conheceu o professor Herbert Marcuse, que apresentou a teoria crítica e a instigou a estudar filosofia na Escola de Frankfurt, na Alemanha. Neste mesmo período, no entanto, o movimento pelos direitos civis e pela libertação negra fortalecia-se nos Estados Unidos, com a criação de organizações como Partido dos Panteras Negras, na Califórnia, em reação à brutalidade policial indiscriminada contra a comunidade negra. Ângela decidiu, então, que era chegada a hora de voltar para casa. Em 1967, ela aterrissou na Califórnia e passou a atuar ao lado de diversas organizações do movimento Black Power, além de filiar-se ao Partido Comunista. No começo dos anos 1970, Angela Davis estava engajada na luta pela libertação de três jovens ativistas encarcerados na prisão de Soledad, quando o adolescente Jonathan Jackson, irmão de George Jackson, um dos três presos políticos, utilizou uma arma comprada por Angela numa ação que previa o sequestro de um juiz como moeda de troca pela liberdade dos rapazes. O evento terminou com a morte do juiz, do próprio Jonathan e de outras pessoas. Como consequência disso, Angela Davis foi acusada de sequestro, conspiração e assassinato. À época, eram todos crimes puníveis com a pena de morte, o que a levou a uma fuga de 2 meses e à inclusão de seu nome na lista dos 10 fugitivos mais procurados pelo FBI. A prisão, em 13 de outubro de 1970, deu início a uma campanha por sua libertação que levou centenas de milhares de pessoas às ruas do mundo todo, num movimento de denúncia e sensibilização que garantiu, depois de 16 meses de prisão, Angela fosse finalmente julgada e declarada inocente, o que representou uma vitória para o movimento em favor dos presos políticos. Desde então, Angela Davis dedica sua vida à luta pela abolição do sistema prisional, aos estudos das relações de continuidade entre passado escravagista e o atual complexo industrial prisional, à defesa do fim da militarização da polícia e às reflexões sobre o papel da mulher negra na sociedade. Sobre este tema especificamente, o livro Mulheres, Raça e Classe, lançado pela Boitempo, traz uma das primeiras análises feministas negras sobre a experiência da escravidão nas Américas, em textos que serviram de base para o surgimento do feminismo negro, relação entre reflexão intelectual e militância política, e o estudo da interseccionalidade, conceito fundamental para pensar as categorias de opressão de gênero, raça e classe. Para a escritora e poeta norte-americana Alice Walker, Angela Davis é a prova de que é possível sobreviver, resistir e superar a força máxima do poder corporativo e o Estado focado na destruição de alguém importante, porque esse alguém inspira a solidariedade coletiva. Com vocês, Angela Davis.
Thank you for the wonderful introduction. And thank you all for the enthusiastic welcome. This is my very first visit to Sao Paulo, although I've been in the airport many times on the way to Salvador. Let me thank SESC and Boitempo for having invited me to participate in this international seminar entitled Democracy in Collapse. I understand that there have been very interesting conversations over the last period. Have most of you attended the other panels and presentations and lectures? Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, I wanted to say that as this conference is taking place here in Brazil, similar conversations are unfolding in the United States, in the UK, as you see, in the Philippines, and in many other parts of the world where democracy is under attack. I am especially moved by the conversations here in Brazil. Particularly when I remember that not long ago, freedom-loving people all over the world, myself included, looked to Brazil as our beacon of hope. Brazil was not only going to show us the path toward economic justice, but having finally acknowledged the spurious representation of racial democracy, Brazil would demonstrate to the world how to genuinely initiate a process that would move in the direction of equality, substantial equality, racial equality, gender equality. Brazil was our hope because this path toward the future emerged as Afro-Brazilians, and especially Afro-Brazilian women, were rising up and redefining democracy, making radical democratic demands for economic, political, and social justice. Reverberations of the 2015 Black Women's March, that wasn't that long ago, do you remember it? The Black Women's March against racism, against violence, and in favor of living well, the good life. These reverberations were felt all over the world. When I spoke at the Federal University of Bahia in the summer of 2017 during Julho das Pretas, I especially remember the young Black women present there. I could personally feel the energy that was driving the demand for change. I also remember that after our sister, Marielle Franco, was assassinated in Rio de Janeiro, and after the elections last year, we won't talk about those, I attended the Black Women's Conference in Guyana, Black Women's Congress in Guyana. And even as people were deeply mourning Marielle and very upset about the coup that removed Dilma Rousseff and about the imprisonment of Lula. Lula Libre. Also expressing their determination to continue the fight for freedom. Marielle lives on, and she remains a beacon of hope to people throughout the world who deeply believe, as she herself did, in the imminent possibility of racial transformation in Brazil, in the Americas, and all over the planet. She did not believe that racism was destined to be a permanent feature of human society. Even with a legacy of 500 years, it could be abolished. You should know that for political reasons, I am always critical of the identity American as referring to those of us who happen to live in what, since the late 1700s, has been referred to the United States of America. As if people who live in the United States are the only ones in the entire hemisphere who deserve to be the particular country that can represent all of the people of the region. As a matter of fact, if there were a country to represent all of the people of the region, it would be Brazil and not the United States of America. It is the same colonizing logic that permits the category human to be represented by humans who are white. Humans whose history is that of slaveholding and colonizing. This logic leads to an internal hierarchy within the very category of human. In the same colonizing way, people from the U.S. stand in for people in the Americas. I have said many times that I would be proud to call myself an American if that designation implied egalitarian relations among all of the people of this hemisphere. Marielle Franco would then be my American sister comrade. As with the people who the current occupant of the White House calls criminals, people whom his projected wall is designed to keep out. They would simply be Americans traveling to another American destination. This imagined America assumes recognition of indigenous people. It assumes the eventual withering away of the nation state and a recognition that what is assumed to be a natural collective identity, the state, is ideological and is historically linked to the rise of capitalism and its bourgeoisie. That is why the oldest national democracies, such as the US and France, privilege the bourgeois class, the white bourgeoisie. And not even all of the white bourgeoisie, because women were excluded. And poor white men were excluded. So we'll talk more about that and the challenge of democracy. But let me say now that black feminisms of the region, as represented by the legacies of Marielle Franco and Luisa Bairros and Leila Gonzalez and Carolina Maria de Jesus, and so many others in Brazil have helped us to shift our thinking about democracy. And I'm also thinking about the black women's movement in Colombia. I'm thinking about the fact that in Costa Rica, Epsi Campbell was recently elected as the first black woman vice president in Latin America. Yes. All of these black feminisms call upon us to reimagine our connectedness, our relationalities, and how they might be expressed if we are not forever encumbered by increasingly obsolete structures of the capitalist nation state. Indigenous people throughout the Americas continually remind us that this is not the world that has always existed. And as Marx and many others pointed out, if it did not exist in the past, then there is no internal imperative that insists on the permanence of these state formations with their militaries and their police and with their border walls. If it did not exist in the past, it can go out of existence in the future. Marielle Franco knew that freedom is a constant struggle. And her legacy continues to be defended by those who carry on the struggle against racism, violence, homophobia, the destruction of the environment. The housing activists, Jacine Ferreira da Silva, Preta Ferreira, and I understand that she was recently released, am I correct? Yes. And that is a victory. We have to celebrate our victories. But I want to quote Preta Ferreira, who said that what this process taught me as a person, as a black woman, as an activist, and poor person, is that I cannot stop. It taught me that I must go on. She said that it is not just free Preta, it's free Pretas. And everybody should recognize that to say free black women is to say we want freedom for all people. When we consider black women's historical struggles throughout this hemisphere, we recognize that there can be no democracy without the participation of black women. And conversely, when black women move toward freedom, they never represent themselves alone. They represent all of their communities. Black communities, indigenous communities, poor communities, communities that suffer economic exploitation, gender oppression, racist violence. As we have said, when black women rise, the world rises with us. This is an important lesson about the struggle for democracy. A democracy that excludes black people is no democracy at all. A democracy that excludes black women is no democracy at all. If you want to understand the secret of establishing paths toward democracy, look at the movements led by black women. Stand with them, support them, and urge others to join. If you do this, you will join the grassroots movements that are really destined to change the world. Democracy is a great deal more complicated than the electoral process that enables us to select political representatives. Moreover, we have only ever historically experienced democracies that are deeply flawed. Democracies that have actively engaged in exclusion. Democracies that have coexisted with slavery, with colonization, and indeed the genocide that enables it. Democracies that have coexisted with and have been shaped by white supremacy. Democracies that render indigenous people invisible. But what am I saying? Don't all of these terms completely contradict democracy or rather cancel out the very notion of democracy? Who has heard of a democracy based on exclusion of the very people who were meant to be protected by democracy? A white supremacist democracy? The point I'm making is that it would be a serious mistake to assume that we simply need to return to a period before the current presidents of the US and Brazil were elected. The one in the US wants to return to the past, prior to civil rights laws, prior to consciousness regarding sexual harassment and violence, prior to our awareness of immigrant rights. He wants to annul So many of our social justice victories, the one here seems to identify with military dictatorships, or maybe I'm wrong. Military dictatorships and police states, am I right? Yes. He wants to return to a past in which the rights of black people, indigenous people, and women were simply not respected. What I'm suggesting is that it would be seriously incongruous for us to assume that the democracy we want resides in the past. Of course, here in Brazil, you can point to a moment, the rise of the Workers' Party, which represented new possibilities and new futures. But those hopes were dashed by the impact of global capitalism. But I think we should always remember that unfulfilled promises that are formulated in the past help us to create agendas for future struggles. This conservative tendency to look toward the past for answers is especially problematic in the US. There are those who assume that if only Clinton had been elected, and I wish he had been elected, but the assumption is incorrect that if only she had been elected, then we would have avoided the current crisis of democracy. It is true despite all of her flaws, there were those of us who argued that people needed to vote against the person who is the current occupant of the White House. We don't call his name, so I just tell you that I will be using various descriptive terms. Because, you know, in some cultures, to call a name is to impart energy, and we do not want to do that. So I'm following the example of the young women in the House of Representatives in the U.S., like Ilhan Omar and Rashida Tlaib and Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez and Ayanna Pressley. So they've taught us to refer to him as the current occupant of 1600 Pennsylvania Avenue. But the point that I'm trying to make is that the election of Clinton would not have solved the problems of the deep economic inequalities, the state violence, racist state violence, and the whole range of racial injustices and structural misogyny. There is one institution in which all of these inequalities and injustices are deeply embedded, which I want to talk about for a moment. I've been doing prison work for the overwhelming majority of my life. And so I would like to talk for a moment about democracy and the prison, which is also linked to structures of policing. Those who are most likely to be subject to policing and imprisonment are people from poor communities, those who are targets of structural racism, and the violence against women that is related to racism. I understand that here in Brazil, where scholars and activists have been examining and have protested the increasing role of the institution of the prisons, and among them there are increasing protests against the return of torture to jails and prisons in Brazil. And I understand that women have been tortured in Bahia, and that in a men's prison, prisoners were forced to take off their clothes, which made me remember the Attica rebellion and the massacre of the prisoners in Attica in 1971. Maybe you've seen the images of the hundreds and hundreds of naked prisoners. They were forced to take off their clothes and sing the Brazilian national anthem. Are you familiar with this? Well, this made me want to reflect a bit on the relation between imprisonment and democracy. And I'll talk about the U.S. The U.S. actually is responsible for offering the institution of the prison to the world. That was perhaps the most obvious gift of U.S. democracy to the world. In the United States, the process or the project of instituting imprisonment as the dominant mode of punishment was linked to the post-revolutionary metamorphosis of government and society during the late 1700s and early 1800s. The rise of the penitentiary in the new United States of America was viewed simultaneously as dramatic evidence of democratization, and also at the same time as symptom of the unacknowledged racial, gender, class inequalities embedded in the very structure of the new democracy. Imprisonment as punishment meant, on the one hand, that the denial of liberty provided negative proof of the emergence of liberty as the social standard. The denial of liberty, which is what imprisonment is all about, right? The denial of liberty was, so to speak, the exception that proved the rule. And during that period, it's so interesting, there were those who argued that neither misdemeanors nor major criminal infractions should provide the justification for denying people of their liberty. And as a matter of fact, there were debates in post-revolutionary America, which got rid of the corporal punishment and all forms of punishments that are now, that were then considered, quote, barbaric. But there were debates regarding the new punishment, the prison, and there were radicals who called for the abolition of all punishments. And had that prevailed, perhaps in the U.S., the invention of the penitentiary would not have happened. And that might have changed the world in many respects. But alas, this viewpoint did not prevail. And although an important, albeit subjugated, element of the intellectual history of the prison is precisely the persistence of arguments from the very beginning, the persistence of arguments for its abolition. They're almost always overshadowed by calls for prison reform. And the prison has obstinately established itself as a permanent and hegemonic institution in U.S. democracy. And ironically, it still presents itself both as evidence of democracy, thus the necessary exception, and as irreconcilable contradiction. The question I want to ask is whether a deeper consideration of the relationship between imprisonment and democracy might establish a more productive framework for arguments against the hegemony of the prison and for prison abolition today, including here in Brazil. The articulation of carceral institutions with neoliberal democratic ideologies, poised against the threat of terror, recapitulates the early history of U.S. democracy as it executed the project of extending rights and liberties to some while denying them to others, denying them most consistently to Black people who were enslaved, to people of African descent who were subject to enslavement. And so the question I want to pose as you conclude this conference on democracy and democracy in collapse, what if imprisonment is so philosophically anchored to liberal conceptions of democracy, inflected and infected by racial exclusion, that we cannot unthink it, much less disestablish its institutions without reconceptualizing democracy? Without reconceptualizing democracy. So this requires us to pay serious attention to the complicated interdependencies of racism and capitalism that are responsible for the peculiar institution of democracy in the U.S. And of course, slavery was always referred to as the peculiar institution. Some of you who've studied that era will be aware of that. But I want to suggest that democracy was the peculiar institution. The punishment of imprisonment, even though it simultaneously relied on and negatively constituted individual rights and liberties, was moved. It was, in a sense, expelled beyond the margins of democracy. In a real sense, it was the negation that liberal democracy required as evidence of its existence. It was and remains the what you might call the constitutive negation of liberal democracy. Carceral punishment, that is to say, punishment that consists in the deprivation of rights and liberties, only makes sense within a society that putatively respects individual rights and liberties. This is why imprisonment as punishment only emerges with capitalist democracy. You know, perhaps instead of saying democracy before, I should have been referring to capitalist democracy. That might make more sense, huh? Particularly if we want to preserve democracy as what we are struggling for in the future. The democracy to come, the democracy of the future, which is not the capitalist democracy of the past. What I was referring to was the fact that the liberal democratic subject knows that they are free Because they are not in prison. But this negation is a necessary negation that demonstrates the value of freedom. In this sense, it's structurally similar to slavery. How did people know they were free during the era of slavery? They could point to slavery. They could point to the slave, and they could say, I know I am not free because I am not a slave. I know I am free, pardon me. I know I am free because I am not a slave. And today we say, I know I am free because I'm not a prisoner. And, you know, there is this persisting fascination with the prison. Prisons were tourist destinations in the 19th century. In the year 1858, 10,000 people visited one of the major penitentiaries in the U.S., the Eastern State Penitentiary. But, of course, some of you may have followed the development of the movements against mass incarceration, the movements for prison abolition in the U.S. and other parts of the world, and right here in Brazil. And it seems to me that the constant call for prison reform, the constant call for democratic reform of the prison, is what has kept that form of punishment alive, and what ultimately enables the violence and the torture and the perpetuation of the notion that the prison is a permanent form of punishment. So where can we look for inspiration for contemporary struggles for democracy? I don't know, some people might say, well, France, we know that France occupies a very important position in the history of democracy, right? What is it? Liberté, égalité, fraternité. But France is not very helpful right now. You know, particularly given the notion of secularity, the very discriminatory notion of secularity assumes that that Muslim women cannot be present at public events in public arenas wearing the hijab. And in some instances, schools have determined that the length of a girl's dress can be transformed into justification for suspension. Yeah, France isn't really helpful right now. Okay, let's look at the U.S. Because the U.S. represents itself as what? The first modern democracy. But I don't think the U.S. is very helpful. And if we think about the original conceptualizations, they were so exclusionary that one would have to acknowledge that the founding era of democracy in the U.S. was really a democracy of the minority, a democracy that involved white people, but actually not only, not simply, not white people as a whole, Because as I pointed out, women were excluded. At the same time, poor white men were excluded. So this was a situation in which there was a democracy of the minority. But doesn't that sound like it's a contradiction in terms? I mean, democracy is, how do you define democracy? How would you define it? Well, the simplest definitions refer to rule of the political rule of the majority, right? But if you look at a country like the U.S., from the outset, it was a minority. It was a democracy of the minority. And I think we can acknowledge that virtually every step forward in U.S. democracy has been accomplished by people who have struggled to challenge racism and economic exploitation and patriarchy and attacks against trans people. And of course, those struggles, and I'm not familiar enough with the situation in Brazil to understand whether there's similarity, but those struggles are often referred to as, what do they call them? Identity politics, right? Special interests. And if you want to imagine a democratic approach, it would be this global universalizing, notion of the all. What does the Constitution say about all people being free? And there should be we should put parentheses in the founding document. Except slaves or black people, except women, except poor people, except. And then by the time we exclude all of those categories that are not included, we see we have a very tiny minority. I want to quote a friend of mine whose name is Linda Burnham, who has been looking at the political situation in the U.S. for a very long time and an active feminist. And she was challenging those who refer to struggles against racism as involving identity politics. She says, in my experience, advocates and organizers for racial justice don't think of themselves as purveyors of identity politics, nor do immigrant rights organizers, advocates for LGBTQ rights or women's rights activists. Rather, in fighting for the expansion of democracy for particular groups, they rev the motor for the renewal and expansion of democracy for the whole. And they know from experience that purportedly universalistic solutions often work to make already embedded inequalities even more rigid. So this is a good argument to present to those who say, well, you shouldn't say black lives matter. You need to say all lives matter. And that all is subject to the same kinds of exclusionary processes that transform it into this universalistic approach. We look to social justice struggles for inspiration, and not struggles for simple inclusion. Because somehow, in the U.S., the watchword is always diversity and inclusion. And I don't know if there's a similar concept here in Brazil. But we look to those struggles that emphasize transformation, that emphasize justice, not only transformation for political democracy, but economic and social democracy as well, for a socialist revisioning and a reorganization of our societies. Increasingly, women are assuming leadership positions in social justice struggles. I mentioned Black Lives Matter in the US. And I'm thinking about the fact that that I have visited Brazil many times, mostly in Bahia, as I pointed out. But I've also been to Brasilia, and I've been to Maranhão, San Luis, I've been to Goiânia. But this is my first time in São Paulo, and it will be my first time in Rio in a few days. So, but I always feel really awkward because I feel as if I'm being made to represent Black feminism. And why is it that you here in Brazil have to look to the United States of America? I don't understand. I mean, I think I've learned more from Lelia Gonzalez than you would ever learn from me. She was writing about intersectionality before the term came into existence. And she called upon us to develop new identities, new political identities. And, you know, I like her term Amerindian and Amer-African. They're broad terms that are inclusive without being assimilatory. I wanted to say that. I always have to say, I feel really awkward because it seems to me that we in the U.S. should be learning from your really vibrant tradition of Black feminism. And as I've pointed out, particularly, you know, given the impact of Candomblé and the ways in which women's leadership has been cultivated and encouraged. Well, there are a lot of other things I could talk about, but let me get back to my notes so that I can finish up. I'm almost done. I wanted, since we're talking about women, I wanted to point out that, and this is what we've learned from people like Lelia Gonzalez, and as important as it may be to dismantle economic and political structures that promote racism and gender inequality, it is also important to break down the ideological and cultural structures that, for example, legitimize gender violence and sexual harassment in intimate as well as in economic and public or quasi-public relationships. There's a lot of discussion around the world about gender violence now, right? The Me Too movement, which has been around for a long time. I mean, if I had time, I would talk about the ways in which Black women, at least in the U.S., and I know also here in Brazil, have been involved in that struggle against violence for decades and decades. And we also have to talk about that gender violence being embedded in certain forms of work. In domestic work, for example. And I am impressed by the level of organizing of domestic workers here in Brazil, far more than in the U.S. I mean, it's very interesting that some of the leaders of the of Black Lives Matter come out of the domestic workers movement in the U.S. Alicia Garza, for example. It is also important to think about that violence as embedded in the institution of marriage. And, of course, this would lead to another lecture. But I'll leave you to reflect on that. And the point that I want to make is that if we neglect this ideological struggle, putative advances, and if we're talking about women, we can say putative advances for women may serve to strengthen the very structures that promote male supremacy and white supremacy. We've recognized recently that, you know what we call the military-industrial complex, right? I mean, you're familiar with that term. Now, women run four of the five largest U.S. corporations associated with the military-industrial complex. So women are in control of the machinery of war. And they also have key positions in the governmental defense hierarchy. And I want to ask you, is this a cause for celebration? Because many of the women who are involved in feminist struggles talk about the glass ceiling, right? You have that concept? But simply incorporating women into positions of power does not guarantee equality or justice in the larger sense. And I think this is a maxim we shouldn't forget. We always seem primed to celebrate individual advancements of Black people, people of color, women, without taking into consideration that diversity by itself may simply mean that previously marginalized individuals have been recruited to guarantee a more efficient operation of oppressive systems. Placing women in control of institutions of state violence has certainly not helped to reduce the incidence of gender violence, neither within the military nor in the larger world. Usual conceptualization simply asks how to achieve diversity and inclusion without attending to the transformations that would also help to achieve justice and set us on a path toward the democracy to come. Should Black people want to be included in a society that remains just as racist as it was before they were asked to join? Should women be invited into a world that remains just as sexist and misogynist as before? Should disabled people be embraced by a society that continues to perpetrate its ableist ideologies and practices? I'm opening up more questions. And I think that's what I wanted to do this evening, raise questions. I don't have the answers. I simply want to point out that democracy is about a great deal more than inclusion and assimilation. It's also about the terms of inclusion. Who needs to be included according to terms that will require us to replicate the structures that are responsible for exclusion? What is the point of endorsing race and gender diversity within a framework that remains heteropatriarchal at its core? Mere assimilation is our enemy, seducing us to participate in apparatuses that more effectively carry out the business of suppressing change. What we need, I think, is radical transformation, socialist transformation. An end to racism, an end to heteropatriarchy, and no more attacks on the environment. Freedom is indeed a constant struggle. Thank you.
E agora iniciaremos a sessão de perguntas, mediada por Adriana Ferreira Silva.
Obrigada pelas palavras. Queria começar por uma questão ligada à autobiografia que acabou de ser lançada aqui no Brasil. Quando a senhora descreve na autobiografia a infância em Birmingham, naquela situação de constantes ataques de supremacistas brancos e de racistas bombardeando e matando famílias negras, a senhora costuma geralmente ligar também esse momento ao terror, ao terrorismo. E para os Estados Unidos, existe uma noção muito particular de terror, né? Queria que a senhora falasse um pouco sobre isso, porque quando esse tipo de terrorismo interno é cometido, em geral, ele não é classificado como terror. Que a senhora tentasse fazer, a senhora costuma fazer isso, fazer essa ligação com quem é definido como terrorista ou não. A Assata Shakur, por exemplo, foi definida como terrorista. Mas um supremacista branco que comete um atentado dentro dos Estados Unidos, em geral, não é designado com esse termo.
Asked whether I heard the beginning of the question, and I said I didn't, but I think you know, it's so interesting that bombs were a daily occurrence. When I was growing up, I think the first time I actually heard the sound of a bomb, I must have been about 3 years old. And the Ku Klux Klan, specific members of the Ku Klux Klan, were bombing people's houses, they were bombing churches, they were bombing synagogues, so that finally, when in October of 1963, the 16th Street Baptist Church was bombed, and the young girls were killed, everybody knew who had done it. everybody knew who had done it because, as a matter of fact, the KKK, the Ku Klux Klan guy's name was Dynamite Bob. And the fact that this could happen with impunity, and that it was supported by the local government, by the state government, this was terror. And that racist terror is very much a part of the history of the United States. It's related to lynchings, you know, extra legal forms of terror, but I think it's important also to point out that it became absorbed into the legal apparatus. And the death penalty today, which continues to be used. The US is the only country, the only so-called industrialized democracy in the world that continues to use capital punishment as a routine form of punishment. And so we can actually see the history of that terror as it expresses itself through the legal system today. I mean, it's very interesting that that lynching did not begin to subside until capital punishment began to be meted out on a regular basis, particularly against black people. So that, I was really angry when there was the assumption that terror always comes from elsewhere, that it's the Muslims who are the terrorists, right? Or it's the, as you pointed out, Assata Shakur, or Patrice Cullors, who's one of the founders of Black Lives Matter. She wrote a really interesting memoir that is entitled When They Call You a Terrorist, because she's been called a terrorist. So it seems as if those of us who represent the impulse toward democracy are the ones who are the terrorists, and those who want to retain a status quo of racism and state violence are the ones who are poised against it. It's very bizarre, isn't it? Don't you think? Don't you think?
Essa biografia em que a gente aprende tantas coisas maravilhosas só existe porque a escritora Toni Morrison convenceu a senhora a escrevê-la quando a senhora tinha 28 anos. E por tudo que eu li, foi ali que a senhora se tornou amiga da Toni Morrison. Eu queria que a senhora contasse um pouco como foi que vocês se conheceram e quais as melhores memórias a senhora guarda da Toni Morrison.
Yeah, Toni Morrison was the person who persuaded me to write this autobiography. I did not know her before she approached me. She was an editor. She wasn't Toni Morrison, right? She was a woman who worked at Random House, which is a major publishing company. And she approached me and asked me if I would be interested in writing an autobiography. And I said, no. I said, who writes an autobiography at the age when they're still in their 20s? It didn't make sense to me. And then I said, besides, I don't consider myself a model. Usually people who write autobiographies share their life experiences with the world because people are supposed to find meaning and supposed to be able to find ways to emulate that person. And so I told Toni, I said, I don't think so. You know. Besides, I knew what kind of autobiography the major publishing companies wanted. You know, they wanted to know. Well, you can imagine. You know, all about your sexual experience. You know what I'm talking about. And I said, I'm not going to do that. And I told Tony, I said, well, the only way I could possibly consider writing an autobiography would be to write a political autobiography, and one that not only allows me to reflect on my own individual experiences, but the experiences of movements, the experiences of all of the communities of struggle. And so finally I agreed. But what's interesting is that she had to fight with those in the hierarchy of the publishing company because they weren't really interested in political, you know, autobiography. They wanted to take advantage of the fact that people knew my name at that particular moment to sell a lot of books and so forth. But I learned a great deal from Toni Morrison. I'm still kind of you know, reeling from her. She died the beginning of July. And I still haven't come to grips with the fact that she's no longer here. And I think I said in a eulogy for her funeral that many people around the world will say that you know, Toni Morrison is not dead because her work is still with us and affecting us and moving us. And that's certainly true. But I said that, you know, those of us who knew her can hardly imagine a world without her laugh. And everyone who knows her knew exactly what I was talking about. In case people weren't aware of the fact that she was responsible for the rise of black women's literature when she was an editor, before she actually became known as a novelist, she found writers and publishers. At one point she said something like, I'm not the person who's out in the streets marching. I'm not doing that work, but what I can do is make sure there is a historical record. And so she published Muhammad Ali's autobiography, she published Huey Newton, George Jackson. She very strategically decided how she was going to make her mark. And then, of course, later she became you know, one of the most well-known novelists in the world. She was absolutely incredible. I could spend the rest of the evening talking about her.
Miss Angela, nós temos muitas, muitas perguntas que chegaram aqui agora. Eu vou tentar separar em blocos. Então, nós vamos passar para o bloco do feminismo. Na sua autobiografia, a senhora relata diversos episódios de sexismo dentro do movimento pela libertação do povo negro. Num dos trechos, a senhora diz: existia uma lastimável síndrome entre alguns ativistas negros do sexo masculino, confundir sua atividade política com a afirmação de sua masculinidade. Queria saber como foi que a senhora atuou para combater esse tipo de comportamento dentro do movimento pela libertação do povo negro e como foi que a senhora passou a se relacionar com o movimento feminista.
It's sort of misleading to assume that there was a feminist movement, which was a primarily white feminist movement, and then there were those of us doing feminist work and other arenas. It took me a long time to embrace the feminist identity. And that's because I conceptualize feminists as white bourgeois. We called it white bourgeois feminism. Right. That assumed that it was possible to address gender inequality without also addressing racism, without also addressing capitalism, economic exploitation. But as a consequence of the fact that we have become aware of the very long history and tradition of black feminism, I wrote a book on black women in the blues called Blues Legacies in Black Feminism, because it became clear to me that blues women, through their music, were doing feminist work. And as a matter of fact, interestingly, in the late 1960s, the early 1970s, with the emergence of a movement against rape and sexual violence, and the emergence of a movement against domestic violence, people were saying, well, this is the very first time that women have publicly engaged in conversations about violence. And when I did this research on women in the blues, I saw that in the 1920s, black women were singing about intimate violence and sharing it and creating community. So I think that over the decades, the whole notion of feminism has been transformed. Probably, what is the term that you associate with feminism now? Let me ask you a question. What? Emancipation, again, somebody else? Equality. Wow, that's great. Now, what about, are you familiar with the term? I know you are, I shouldn't ask like that, but intersectionality. Is that a feminist term? Is it?
Yes.
Is that the kind of feminism that you embrace?
Yes.
Okay. Struggle for equality.
Right. Equality for whom? Yeah. So I think over time, those of us who were reluctant to identify with feminism have recognized that feminism itself has transformed. And that at one point, the assumption might have been that feminist struggle excluded struggles for racial justice or economic equality. But now I think feminism allows us, and when I say feminism, I'm not talking about anybody's feminism. I'm talking about the kind of feminism that attends to, you know, all of these forms of oppression, the kind of feminism that is Marxist inflected, histories and anti-imperialist, anti-capitalist feminism, definitely anti-capitalist feminism. And feminism that recognizes that capitalism has always been connected to racism, that as a matter of fact, we cannot talk about capitalism without evoking racial capitalism. Capitalism has always been racial capitalism. Slavery was the primitive accumulation for the capitalism that is associated with the Industrial Revolution. And that would be the subject of another lecture. But you get what I mean? Okay. It has to be a capacious feminism, a feminism that that recognizes that it is our responsibility to express solidarity with the Kurdish women in Rojava and with. And I should have actually talked about this during my presentation. Now, you know, I'm thinking out loud about what I should have said. But the experiment in democracy that is happening in northern Syria, that the Turkish government wants to destroy, and then what's his name who lives at 1600 Pennsylvania Avenue, Washington, D.C., just withdrew troops. And many people aren't aware of the fact that the Kurdish troops that were fighting ISIS consisted of large numbers of women. Women fighters. Not only women fighters, but also a campaigns designed to guarantee women's equality. So that if you look at that community, you see that there are campaigns against gender violence, against intimate violence. Women are fighters, they are in the military, but at the same time, the men have been required to completely shift their notions of what it means to be in a relationship with a woman. And so, I mean, broadly speaking. That kind of feminism. Kurdish women's feminism, that kind of feminism. That's what I identify with.
Em duas perguntas que vieram da plateia com o mesmo tema. O encarceramento feminino aumentou 700% nos governos Lula e Dilma entre 2006 e 2016. Deve-se considerar esse governo parte do Estado penal e racista? Mesmo um governo dito de esquerda deu continuidade ao encarceramento negro e o genocídio negro?
Okay, which government? Yeah, right. You know, that's a... That's an important question. And I want to propose a feminist answer in the sense that I'm not going to choose one or the other. I'm going to say that we have to hold those notions in tension and recognize that the Workers' Party did represent hope and that did generate new possibilities. And at the same time, there were very problematic aspects, including the continued expansion of the prison population. At the same time as the prison population was expanding here in Brazil, it was expanding in South Africa. And we were confronted with exactly the same dilemma. You know, what do you do when you finally get a government in South Africa that has overturned, that is a result of the overturning of apartheid, and that represents itself as non-racist and non-sexist, and non-homophobic, written into the Constitution, and at the same time, the prison population continues to soar as a consequence of the impact of global capitalism and its neoliberal ideologies. I would refuse to choose one of the two alternatives the person gave me, and I would say that if we see ourselves as moving in a progressive direction, we also have to learn how to live with contradictions. We have to learn how to straddle contradictions. And it was Audre Lorde who emphasized the feminist imperative of learning how to dwell within the contradiction, as opposed to always being compelled to choose one or the other. If someone had asked me about Obama, I would have said, that sounds like a long time ago, doesn't it, when Obama was, you remember that we have once had somebody named Obama occupy 1600, I'll call his name, 1600 Pennsylvania Avenue. Well, there were many things that I totally disagreed with. But at the same time, I thought it was important that finally a black person, a black man, could be elected president of the United States. But I was really critical of many of his policies and many of his practices. And I still am. But I still am celebratory. I mean, you see, I think it's really important for us to learn how to inhabit those contradictions in that way and not feel so torn by them that we become immobilized and can't do the work that will lead us in the direction of freedom.
O que a privatização das prisões significa para o fortalecimento do Estado penal?
Yeah, prison privatization. Privatization is not simply the private ownership of prisons. And the beginning of that process of privatization, which began in the US, of course, the first private prison companies. Corrections Corporation of America. And it was an indication of a whole juggernaut of privatization. Not only privatization of punishment, but privatization of education, privatization of healthcare. As a matter of fact, the first private prison corporation was modeled after the first hospitals, private hospital corporation, which was called Hospital Corporation of America, right? Corrections Corporation, and they had an interlocking directorate. Some of the same members of the board of directors were on each board. And so I think that we can't consider the privatization of prisons in isolation from the larger impact of global capitalism and from the fact that wealth is increasingly concentrated within a increasingly smaller number of hands in the world. I mean, how is it that eight men own and control more wealth than half of the planet's population? I mean, that is absolutely obscene, isn't it? Can you imagine? And so the when one considers specifically private prisons, the privatization of prisons, I think it's important to recognize that the reason why prison populations have grown so over the last decade, since the 1980s, is precisely because of the breakdown of the institutions that were designed to attend to people's needs. The destruction of what we used to call the welfare state, right? And the shifting of capital from areas that were designed to attend to people's needs, like schools and, you know, hospitals and other healthcare facilities and recreation and, you know, all of the things that human beings need in order to lead decent lives. When capital begins to shift in a direction that is designed to guarantee profit, and this means also that deindustrialization happens. I know you've experienced it here in Brazil. We've experienced it in the US when corporations began to migrate to other parts of the world where labor forces were much cheaper. And then what do you do with the people who are left without jobs, particularly in the context of not having any services to provide for them? Well, this is why we saw in the 1980s and 1990s this vast movement of prison construction. So if people lose their jobs, if they can't figure out how to live, if they don't have housing, because housing becomes increasingly expensive, what do? Put them in prison. Put them in prison. That solves the problem. And not only does it solve the problem, but it also creates new possibilities for the generation of profit. So you have all of these people in prison, you know, they need certain kinds of things to live, and these companies make contracts with the prisons that, you know, the telecommunications industry in the US is totally tied to prisons because prisons make phone calls. And if you knew how expensive it was to make a phone call inside of a prison compared to how much it costs to make the same collect phone call outside, you would understand how they're taking advantage of. So it's not just privatization of prisons. That's the point that I'm making. The point that I'm trying to make, it's the impact of global capitalism on the whole process of punishment and the creation of ever more creative means of generating profit. And that's a shame. I mean, that's what people like, what's his name who lives at 1600 Pennsylvania? That's the only thing they think about, is how much. How much money are you gonna make? And I mean, that's a simple way of putting it, but capitalism is destroying our world. And we have to do something about it. You know, first of all, we have to develop the kind of popular discourse, popular conversation that puts people in a position of being able to understand and talk about these processes, because they affect our lives. They affect our futures. I mean, this is why Greta Thunberg decided to demonstrate, because she could not deal with the fact that what these corporations are doing is destroying the future. It's destroying young people's future. And I think, You know, oftentimes people think of autism as a defect, but I think sometimes it's a real gift. Because she, I'm speaking about Greta Thunberg, because she's on the spectrum and just really had a hard time forgetting about all of these things she learned about, you know, how the planet was in the process of being destroyed. Yeah, it's all connected too. It's all connected, and I think, you know, that's why when we talk about these issues, and sometimes we talk about them in broad global terms, I've been talking about global capitalism, I think it's important to have that as a backdrop to realize the reverberations and the repercussions, and then at the same time be able to point to this very specific issue of what am I going to do to guarantee that no more jails or prisons are constructed. In New York, we've been fighting for a long time to close down Rikers Island. I don't know if any of you have been to New York, or if any of you know about Rikers Island. Yeah? Yeah, it's... What? Right, yes, who killed himself after, yeah. And the fact that it's the largest, it's one of the largest mental institutions in the country, as a matter of fact, the three largest mental and psychiatric institutions in the U.S. are county jails. You know, one of them is Rikers Island, the other is the jail in L.A., L.A. County Jail, and the other is Cook County Jail in Chicago. But finally, they agreed to shut down Rikers Island, which has this long, this terrible, terrible history. But they want to build three new jails. And so there are those who are saying, shut down Rikers and no new jails. This is what the abolitionist movement is, and I hope here in Brazil that there are similar campaigns, because you have increasing numbers of jails being and prisons being built here in this country as well, and one of the largest imprisoned populations, number three behind China, U.S. Is it U.S., China, and Brazil?
Yes.
I've read some material that says it's the fourth behind Russia, China, and then Brazil, but whatever. You know, Brazil has a very large imprisoned population.
We are importing the U.S. model system of incarceration
and privatization. And as she was saying, you're importing the U.S. model of mass incarceration. Yeah, that's the whole point. If you can't deal with people's needs, get rid of the people who have the needs. If you can't deal with the problems, the economic problems, the medical problems, just get rid of the people, put them in prison. Then you don't have to address these social issues that you know governments should be addressing. I'm sorry, we can go on and on with this conversation.
Tem uma pergunta do senador Eduardo Suplicy. Ele que gostaria de saber como a senhora avalia a proposta de ter uma renda básica universal. Em todos os países. E aí ele usa como exemplo o fato de que o Prêmio Nobel de Economia, o professor Abit... Perdão, professor Suplicy, eu não consegui entender o nome. Obrigada. Da Índia e do Instituto MIT, Ele é super entusiasta desse modelo de renda básica. Isso, então, seria uma boa notícia?
Well, thank you very much, Senator. We shouldn't even have to answer this question. It should be taken for granted that everybody, by virtue of the fact that they inhabit this earth, should have the means with which to survive. I don't even think it should be a question. It only becomes a question under conditions of capitalism. It only becomes a question. And this is why I also think it is important to retain memories of the socialism that is no longer with us. And as I was saying before, it's possible to be both critical and at the same time embrace that which is going to help us move in a forward direction. I was drawn to communism precisely because of the fact that I believe that every human being who inhabits this earth should have the capacity to live. And the socialist countries, whatever the problems may have been, did provide examples of how people can live, and how they can study, and how they can eat. I had a friend years ago who was on welfare in the US. And she had a child, and she wanted to study. But there was no hope for her. There was no way she was going to study. She had to work in order to support the child. She actually decided to go and live in the Soviet Union. People thought she was absolutely out of her mind. But she got there. Her housing cost like 5% of her income. She had free childcare. She had free education. She got her BA. She got her PhD. And she ended up being a pretty prominent scholar. Now, in the US, there was no hope at all for that trajectory. And I think that we need the kind of social order that is going to allow people to achieve their dreams, to maximize their capacity, to work for all of us, to give to the larger community. And having a basic annual income, that's just the beginning. There should be a guaranteed annual income for all. Everybody who agrees with that, raise your hand. Okay, so maybe what you need to do is the bill, when is the bill going to be considered?
More than the bill, it's approved the bill 15 years ago, sanctioned by President Lula, and it says that it's going to be instituted step by step. Perhaps it's to tell.
And where are you now? What step are you? So you're saying you haven't even gone to step one yet?
There is a city in Brazil, Marica, who is starting
Wonderful.
One third of the population until the next year. At the end, 150,000 people of Marica will be receiving a citizen basic Wonderful. Income for all, 130 reais or just over
Well, you know, thank you. And I think, I think it's just really sad that we're at this point, you know, that, that if it had not been for the ways in which capitalism has not only changed the external world, but infected our ways of thinking, that it would have been obvious to everybody in the world that this is what we need. And if you here in Brazil can do this, this would perhaps be one of the most effective ways of challenging the person who is, I don't know where he lives, but you know who I'm talking about.
Miss Angela, acho que, acredito que pelo fato da senhora ser vegana, vieram, tem um bloco, muitas perguntas ligadas à necessidade de libertação animal, como o feminismo pode, de alguma maneira, atuar pela fim da exploração dos animais e a ligação entre a libertação dos animais e a democracia.
You know, when we think about freedom, I know that the title of this lecture was Freedom is a Constant Struggle. And I've actually been thinking about freedom for a very, very long time. And the more I reflect on the meaning of freedom, which was the title of another book of essays that I wrote, the more I recognize that that we have no idea what it will mean to be free. And 100 years from now, or 500 years from now. And I often think about people who were enslaved 400, 500 years ago, and that impulse toward freedom that they felt, and how they must have imagined a life that was very different from the one and that they were compelled to live. But it's also clear that they could not have possibly imagined the ways in which we have come to conceptualize freedom. I always like to use the example of what we have accomplished in the last, say, decade or so around the issue of transgender persons. And how the gender binary, which was considered the absolute foundation of our notions of normalcy, has been completely challenged and refuted. 20 years ago, I don't think people would have been able to imagine how important the campaign for in support of trans rights in prison and in other places, and I say this to point out that I'm convinced, I don't know whether I will live long enough to actually experience it myself, but I am convinced that there will come a time in the future when we will understand how damaging our capitalist mode of industrialized production of food is, not only in terms of the cruelty and the violence that inflicted on animals, but the damage that is done to the earth. I mean, I understand that Brazil is one of the largest producers of soybeans, right? And of course, you know, they feed soybeans to animals. They feed a lot of things to animals that animals shouldn't even be eating. They feed corn, and it's a question of profit. And the reason why people have learned how to eat hamburgers produced by these fast food joints has very little to do with people's needs, but rather it has to do with profit. Somebody's making a lot of money from the fact that you know, animals are treated as cruelly as they are, that the land is being destroyed by you know, using pesticides to grow these huge crops. Yeah, you know, when you think about it, it's sort of dizzying. But I do think that we should develop ways of being conscious of what we do in the world, how we live in the world, how we eat. I mean, I stopped eating meat a long time ago, before I had an awareness of the political problem and the ethical problem. I started eating meat when I was in jail, because they were serving meat that had maggots, and it was nasty. And over time, I've become aware of the politics of eating. Not in a way that drives me to tell you what you should eat and what you shouldn't eat. But I'm simply trying to urge you to be aware, to be conscious, to think about what it is you eat, what it is you put into your body, which may also be responsible for disease and all kinds of health issues. But it makes no sense for one to have this awareness as an individual if it is not linked to a larger community. And I do think that over the next period, as I said, I'm not sure when, given the extent to which Monsanto is colonizing the entire earth, you know, companies that are responsible for the worst kind of pesticides and literally poisoning the earth, poisoning the water, and this is connected to, I think, an awareness of indigenous people and their historical role in being stewards of this part of the world that we inhabit. So when I think about intersectionality, I think about the importance of the intersections of various struggles, to think about connections and interrelationalities. And we can't accomplish everything simultaneously, but we can develop practices, knowledge practices, practices of consciousness that allow us to move in a direction of recognizing how everything is so deeply interconnected. And you know something? If we can't manage to save the planet, if we can't manage to save the earth, it's okay. You know, it's just, you know, we have these devices, they go off. They don't have to bother us. But if we can't manage to save the earth, then nothing else we do will be of value. So, you know, whatever we're doing, we should be thinking about the planet. We should be thinking about the earth. We should be thinking about the ocean. We should be thinking about the air.
Ms. Davis, outra questão recorrente aqui em diversas perguntas é ligada ao socialismo. Há tanto questões como questionando se o capitalismo estaria por um fio, quanto questões sobre se o socialismo poderia ser uma realidade possível. E aí eu queria aproveitar e incluir nesse bloco socialismo, tem uma questão aqui do embaixador de Cuba que está aqui conosco. Ele diz que, em nome da democracia e dos direitos humanos, Cuba vem sofrendo embargo e punida pelos Estados Unidos há mais de 60 anos, e a situação tem ficado cada vez mais difícil. Ele queria que a senhora comentasse sobre isso.
Ok. Well, I guess I would say, viva la revolución cubana! We have been inspired so much over time by the persistence of the Cuban people, even in light, as you were pointing out, of all of the embargoes and the attacks, the Cuban people have taught us, you know, what it means to defend their way of life, free education, accessible housing. You know, the things that we were talking about when we had the conversation about a basic universal income for all. You know, I have to believe that there is some form of socialism on the horizon. I am never going to say yes to capitalism. Never. And I think it is even more important than ever to develop an anti-capitalist consciousness and anti-capitalist movements because capitalism thinks it has triumphed. And it thinks that it can. I'm not trying to attribute human qualities to capitalism. Capitalism does not think. But the fact that capitalism has been represented as triumphal in the aftermath of the dismantling of the socialist community of nations means that it's more important than ever before, because we don't want this to be a permanent human predicament. Capitalism asserts its permanence, and I think that we have to point out that capitalism does not respond to the needs of the human beings or other beings who inhabit this earth. Capitalism is poised to move in the direction of death. Death for workers, death for animals, death of the planet, and it does not care as long as that trajectory is profitable. So we definitely have to figure out something better. Something that will allow those who come after us to thank us for the work we did in preserving the possibility of a future for them.
Ms. Davis, outra questão recorrente é sobre violência contra a mulher. E eu vou aproveitar e listar aqui alguns dados do Brasil, falando especificamente sobre estupro. No Brasil, hoje, se registra mais de 180 estupros por dia, num recorde desse tipo de violência em 2018, com 66.041 registros, um aumento de 5% em relação a 2017. Por outro lado, nunca se falou tanto em feminismo como na última década, nunca as mulheres estiveram tão engajadas. Como a senhora mesma mencionou, mulheres negras ocuparam as ruas, centenas de milhares de mulheres negras brasileiras foram às ruas em manifestações. As manifestações que a gente aqui no Brasil ficaram conhecidas como Ele Não, contra a eleição do presidente Jair Bolsonaro, foram organizadas por mulheres. Essa epidemia de estupro seria um reflexo da política conservadora? Seria uma reação ao engajamento das mulheres em movimentos como Me Too, por exemplo?
Well, violence against women is the most pandemic form of violence in the world. And certainly, in the years that I've been coming to Brazil, I've been made aware of both the terror and how women are standing up, and not only women, men as well are standing up to challenge that violence. Yeah, I think that it's all interconnected. It's, you know, oftentimes we think of violence against women as just being something that unfolds among individuals within relationships and strangers, but it's structural. It's a part of the social, political, economic structures, and I don't know enough about the political circumstances to provide an analysis of the way in which you formulated the question, connection between the rise in the number of rapes and the new political conditions. But I think when you have huge numbers of women saying "Ele não," is that right? "Ele não," that he's going to want to do something about that. I guess I would think that the best way to begin to challenge that violence is to continue to build movements, to make them stronger, and to recognize that this is not about attacks on individual women. It's you know, I like the old union saying, an injury to one is an injury to all. And when I say all, I'm not just talking about all women, I'm talking about all men as well. And I think we have to recognize particularly when we talk about violence and sexual violence, that it's trans women who suffer more consistently of these kinds of violences, you know, whether it's individual violence or state violence. And you know, just as I was trying to make the argument before, that when you struggle against racism, it benefits not only those who are the direct targets of racism, it benefits the entire society. And when you stand up in defense of trans women, and particularly black trans women, who are suffering these forms of violence that helps us to begin the process of purging our societies of gender violence. So how many more questions do we have?
A lot.
No, so you got all of those questions?
Two more questions?
Oh, yeah, no, that's fine. No, I saw you had about 50 there. And I was like, I think people are going to get a little tired. Okay, two more questions.
Two more questions. Aos 28 anos, a senhora achava que merecia uma autobiografia. E agora, a senhora acha que merece?
I don't know. Maybe. We'll see. I don't have any immediate plans. But I am thinking about a writing project that involves the lives of others. Because I actually, you know, like to... I don't always enjoy being the center of attention. You know, I like to do the background work that that helps others to move forward. That's my favorite thing to do. And so my next book project is about that.
A última pergunta, acho que é um desejo que também passou assim por várias outras questões que estão aqui comigo. Eu vou entregar todas reunidas para ela depois. A nós, pretos brasileiros, nos é imposto que sejamos mansos e obedientes, visto que a falácia do país não racista é perpetuada por gerações. Existe a possibilidade de não ser preto raivosa? Como não ser preta raivosa? Qual o caminho?
Anger. You know, I have problems with anger only when it's misdirected. But anger that is directed and that helps to move us in struggle, that's righteous anger. And I know black women have a reputation of being angry. And I think that's good. Because someone has to express anger about the way the world is organized. And so read Audre Lorde's essay on the uses of anger.
Obrigada, Miss Angela. Acho que a quantidade de perguntas que a gente recebeu reflete o desejo que a gente tinha que a senhora viesse para cá. Então, por favor, volte. Volte mais vezes.
Well, thank you all so much. I really enjoyed spending these hours with you. Even though I didn't get any sleep last night, I flew in directly from New York and arrived this morning. But it's been really inspiring and energizing to be in your presence. So I want to thank you.